Hello and welcome to the inaugural episode of the Gaming Rage-ologist podcast. I'm your host, Gaming Psychologist, and with me, my co-host,
Caffeine Rage.
On today's podcast, we're going to be talking about the games we played this week, Steam reviews, how useful can they be, really, MOBAs, and a few upcoming games from the Christmas sale this week. But, of course, starting with games we played this week, Rage, what have you played this week?
Well, for myself, I always have this sort of general staple of games that I play. I have Warframe, that is one of those games that I could just jump in and play for half an hour or so, and also Binding of Isaac Rebirth, which I have something like 120 some videos on my YouTube channel for.
Yeah, there's a lot there.
Both of those games are things that I just jump in and play every so often, but this week I've played a couple different things. I'm actually recovering a bit from an illness. Nothing life-threatening. It just feels that way. And I played a bit of Spin Tires this week. Have you ever seen that one?
I have seen it. I've never played it. To me, it looks like a great podcast kind of zen game to play, but I've never played it.
Yes and no. Spin Tires, it has moments of just, you know, just calm, zen moments, and then there's times of unfiltered rage.
Okay.
For those who don't know, Spin Tires is it's basically off-road version of Euro Truck Simulator, where you have to haul logs from a loading point to one or more objectives, depending on the map. And what really differs from Euro Truck Simulator is that it's all off-roading. Well, for the most part, I should say. And they are very, very detailed on land deformation. Actually, surprisingly detailed on it, where as you go across roads, they'll actually degrade over time. An example of this was, I'm blanking on the map, I think it's Coast, where one road is partly submerged. It's like a land dam under the water, and you could see just the color of the dirt, and then it drops off into just blue water. Mm-hmm. Well, on my last load of logs there, the road had degraded to the point where my truck was starting to slip underwater too much, and I was starting to take damage on my truck.
Well, just turn into a boat.
Unfortunately, it doesn't work like that.
Is there any way to fix that?
Not really. You can bring in bigger trucks. I'm blanking on the number. It's basically like this giant end loader, only without a bucket. And you can literally just drag a truck through water. And it only really takes damage if the engine is actually running at the time, which is a little unrealistic, but you know, you have to make some sacrifices on realism. Otherwise, it would just be maddening.
Right. So you can't come in with like a front end loader or something and repair the dirt roads?
Not that I know of. There might be a mod for that, because it has workshop support and there's just a ton of vehicles, and I'm just playing the vanilla game right now. And the other way is there's usually at least two routes through the map from the objective to your loading point. So you could take a harder route. The water route that I was talking about was actually the easier way to get to the objective. The other way had this really gnarly hairpin turn that went uphill, and I may have rolled a load of logs there.
Okay. Well, at least that sounds like fun.
Like I said, it's a very zen game, but at times it just has me just ungodly pissed off. And usually at myself and not at the game, which is actually a good sign of the difficulty of the game, because it doesn't feel like the game's punishing me for no reason.
It doesn't feel like it's unfair. It just feels like I'm not good enough to do this yet.
Yeah, it feels like I tried to make too hard a turn. I tried to take too steep a heel with this truck. That sort of thing.
That's really good, actually. You don't find too many games that do that. That's a difficult difficulty curve to walk. Sure, we'll go with that. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's really where it steps away from Euro Truck Simulator, the other really big trucking sim, at least on PC at the time of recording this, or Well, I shouldn't say that. There is Elite Dangerous, but that's another story.
That's space trucking.
Yeah.
I've done my fair share of space trucking in Elite Dangerous.
But that's where it really separates itself, is it has a more of a difficulty curve than Euro Truck Simulator, where it's Euro Truck Simulator is really the zen game where you just put on a podcast, put on some music, and just go.
Yeah.
And there's really no challenge outside of loading and unloading points, and that is usually half an hour to an hour away, if I recall correctly. I haven't actually played Euro Truck Simulator in a while.
I haven't played two. Euro Truck Simulator 1, though, is a much smaller map. So, about a half an hour is average. But Euro Truck Simulator 2, you can actually truck all the way across Europe, so you can get multi-hour routes that you have to go on, so...
Yeah, and I don't have all the DLC for it. I don't have the Scandinavia DLC, which adds even more.
What else have you played this week?
I went back and played Besiege.
Nice.
Have you played Besiege?
I have played Besiege a bit. I don't own it, but I think it had a free weekend or something like that on Steam, and I've played it then, and it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, Besiege, the physics puzzle game.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually the first time I played it since they did the big Uni 5 upgrade.
I haven't played it since then. I played it before then.
Oh, it runs butterly smooth now. It's really amazing just how much they've optimized that game. Still not through all the content that they have in it. It's one of those games that I play for a little bit, then I don't want to say I get frustrated, just I get tired of having to scrap my entire machine and rebuild essentially from scratch for each level.
Right.
Which is not a flaw in the game. It's just a flaw in me.
Something you don't like doing.
Yeah, I wish I had a way to... I don't want to say just download templates, but be able to just build my templates a lot easier. Because right now, if there's a way to do it, but it's kind of cumbersome. At least what I recall, I didn't try it in the latest version that I played, which I'm not... have no idea what the version number is on it. It's literally just the version after Uni 5. I don't think they've put out another major one since then. I'll check my Steam library and see if they have a version number. It's okay, version number 0.23. So they actually had a upgrade after... No, they've had an upgrade after Uni 5. So it's a minor upgrade, but nothing major. But I wish I could just go in and build, just a template to be able to, put a car in and then just build off that instead of building a car each time that I need it. And it seems like the puzzles tend to jump back and forth between needing mobility and needing, just firepower. And you have to have those templates, and it's just not a good way to do it just yet. But the game is there. It's a really interesting early access game. It's actually... probably my choice for early access right now, since the major games that I played in early access are all out of it now.
Yeah, like KSP, which a lot of people have compared Besiege to KSP, and there's some similarity there. But
yeah,
KSP is much more of just a giant sandbox to play in.
Yeah, which there is a sandbox mode in Besiege. It's not a great one yet. It's still under development.
Yeah, isn't it just one level that you can go play around with stuff in?
Yeah, but there's a lot of stuff there.
Okay.
Just different routes and things to tour around with the different configurations I shouldn't say ship, but a vehicle. And I think a lot of reason why people compare Besiege to KSP is it's kind of the same idea of just slapping parts together like Legos.
Right.
And the Uni 5 upgrade for Besiege has me really excited for the Uni 5 upgrade for KSP because of just how much of an upgrade it had on the frame rate, because it had the same limiting factor of the more parts you put on a machine, the lower your frame rate went until frame rate death.
True, but in Besiege, can't you speed up the timing of the game? So even if you've got a really crappy frame rate that you're dealing with, stuff can still work.
Yeah, you can, but then you start running into the same problem that you have with physics time warp in KSP, where the errors start piling up and piling up, and things happen that aren't supposed to happen.
Okay, I gotcha.
So that's why having a good optimization of the game is actually really important, even if you could control time. Because, the more accurate the simulation is, the less bad things happen just randomly. So, Jared, what have you been playing?
Well, for the last week, I have been traveling. I'm in Colorado right now, which is... Absolutely. Which is about 1,400 miles away from my home. And until tonight, the internet has been incredibly unreliable. So I've been playing iOS games on my phone's hotspot.
Yeah.
Which, most of them have been eh, because, you know, iOS games for the most part are your standard kind of clicker games and paying money to win games and Clash of Clans.
I do have to say that mobile gaming in general, now, I should preface this that I don't actually own a cell phone because until like 3 weeks ago, I lived in a spot where getting coverage for cell phones was nigh impossible, so there was really no reason for me to even bother with it. But from as an outsider looking in, it just looks like it's just a sea of mediocrity, of borrowing, I should say borrowing and sarcasm quotes, ideas, and just not a lot of real gems outside of higher paid games, which then you start running into the issue of people don't want to pay that much for a game to play on your toilet.
Yep. Like, you know, there's some good ports like XCOM and the older KOTOR games have been ported now and they work pretty well. And some others like that, but mostly, yeah, it's just cheese and bullshit and pay-to-win stuff. Which is sad because, you know, everybody, well, not everybody, but almost everybody has got a mobile phone. It's one of the greatest gaming devices that we have access to, and it's just loaded with garbage. But there are gems in it, and this week I have found two, actually.
Oh, really?
Yes. The first one is called X-Mercs, which is pretty much somebody said, hey, XCOM's pretty cool. What if I just copy that game and add some stuff to it and put it, make it a mobile game? And that's basically, I mean, it's basically XCOM, the remake of XCOM that came out a few years ago, not the original XCOM. But it's got all of the same elements. You build a base, you recruit troops and train them, and then you go on missions and you control them in turn-based style battles. It is surprisingly really good. And so far, the game model has not been exploitative. Like, only once has it popped up and said, hey, here's these cool items you want to buy, like kind of a starter pack. I've not seen any point where you can buy a premium currency to use. I think that all you can buy is in-game currency. So if you want more, whatever dollars it is that it uses in-game, you can pay for those. And then the multiplayer has a separate currency, like the PvP currency. Mm-hmm. It's got entirely separate PvP gear and everything. But I haven't seen like tons of ads like, oh, hey, buy our currency, buy these things. Like the way that you speed up things in-game, like in most mobile games, you have to buy a second currency like gems or whatever and use those. But in this game, you can just spend money to accelerate construction, like in-game money. And then there's one item that you can use to accelerate construction, but it's an in-game item. You can't buy it in a shop. So the business model is actually quite fair for a free-to-play game. And, I mean, it plays exactly like XCOM. And I love XCOM. So I've played this game for probably 8 or 9 hours this week.
Wow, that's epic for a mobile game, isn't it?
Yeah. I'm really enjoying it. I would recommend it to anybody who's listening to this that wants a game for an iOS device that is fun and not super exploitative. Now, granted, mobile games tend to have a kind of a floor that you hit or a ceiling that you hit.
Yeah, and then it turns into you run up against the grind wall.
Yeah, you run up against the grind wall. So far, I haven't hit the grind wall after, like I said, 8 to 10 hours. But I know that it could still be there, so I might report back on this next time and with my findings, but. So far, very fair, very fun. The other game is one that I found called Galactic Fantasy. It's a space combat trading sim game, but it's a lot more on rails than something like Freelancer is. You have a lot less control over your craft. Since
I was going to say, I've been playing Freelancer recently. I'm not sure if you get much more on rails than that at times.
Well, with Freelancer, at the very what I mean by on rails is that in Freelancer you at least have 6 degrees of freedom
in
your maneuvering and things like that. And this is a lot more like menu interactions, like where do you want to go in the star system? Okay, let's go there and let's dock at this place and let's trade or let's accept a mission. The only time that you get real control of your vessel is if you do a combat mission or run into pirates or something like that. And even then, you're still restricted. Basically, you can move towards or away from an enemy. You can move vertical or, vertically up or down in relation to them. And then you can move left or right in relation to them. But it's kind of like the Z-targeting system from Zelda. Where that you are, all of your movement is centered around whatever you're targeting.
Interesting. So
that can be a bit frustrating because, I mean, there's all of space out there that I could use to maneuver, and I'm stuck to maneuvering around whatever vessel that I have. But outside of that, it reminds me a lot of games like Freelancer. There is a story that you can explore and partake in, but you can completely ignore it and just go be a space trader and take on combat missions or things like that. But it's also a lot of fun. I've only played it for about 3 or 4 hours. I find X Marks a lot more fun. But X-Marks does require an internet connection. So with the internet being spotty and my cell phone signal being spotty where I am, I don't always have internet. And so when I don't, I pop on to Galactic Fantasy because it's 100% offline. Galactic Fantasy is also a game that you purchase. When I bought it, it was $4.99. Okay. There's no microtransactions or anything like that in it. It's just a straight up buy.
Yeah, do you prefer on mobile devices to just buy a game outright for $5, maybe $10 at the ceiling, or have the microtransactions where you unlock parts of it?
It depends on what the game is. Although I would say overall, I prefer to just buy games. I mean, I've paid... The sweet spot for me for mobile devices is $5. Like, if you can make your game available for $5 with no microtransactions, no ads, and still make a profit on it, that's the sweet spot. Because for me, it's like, oh, it's $5, whatever. I have bought games for $10 and even $15 on mobile devices, but it's a lot more careful purchase that I make. But purchasing is definitely better to me than free-to-play. I just hate being constantly bombarded by microtransactions and stuff. I mean, all of my favorite free-to-play games don't really do that. The system is available to you. You can make the purchases if you want, but they don't like shove it in your face. And a lot of the games, particularly on mobile devices, just shove it in your face every time you log in. Oh, hey, check out this deal we've got on our premium currency. You can get an extra 10% when you spend $40 on premium currency. I'm like, why would I ever spend $40 on premium currency?
Well, unfortunately, AAA gaming is going more towards the mobile market, where all these little microtransactions for what used to be cheat codes and just level skips and all that sort of thing have kind of crept into AAA gaming, and it's really kind of maddening.
Yep, and I hate it. And the only reason they're doing it is because they can.
Yep.
There hasn't been... Eventually, there will hit a point where the people will say, nope, we've had enough, this is it. But they haven't pushed most people that far yet.
I look forward to that day.
Me too. I refuse to spend money on kind of AAA developed games. Like, if a game costs more than $30 or $40, I'm not spending any money on it unless it's for expansion content. You know, I mean, I paid for my game. Now stop asking me for money unless you're going to give me something more than currency or progression speed ups. Does that about cover it for our games for the week and our little side rant? Okay.
Yeah, we are kind of spinning off of another podcast there. It's very famous of getting off topic.
We are. In case you guys are listening to this and you don't know, we both started on another podcast called Kerbalcast, which is a podcast dedicated completely to Kerbal Space Program, and then occasionally, or well, a lot of times whenever the hosts go off on rabbit trails. And then we started doing streaming about Kerbal Space Program, and now our streams have turned into 3 hours about talking about video games other than Kerbal Space Program, so we wanted to do our own podcast and see how we could do with it. So here we are.
And that's the history.
Yeah. Some of it. If we're successful, we'll kind of tease that out to you. We'll tease the rest of our history to you. We're naughty.
Oh my.
Oh my. Anyways, moving on to the next topic, the end of daily and flash sales during the Steam sales.
This is a topic that I'm of two minds about. I understand where they're coming from, but at the same time, I don't like it because how it's impacted me. Now, granted, I'm someone that can just sit around and watch the daily deals, watch the flash sales come and go, because, well, I have no life. And the reason, at least the speculation, I should say that at least of recording this in December of 2015, Valve has never said when, or not when, but why they removed the flash sales and the daily deals from their major sales, I should say, and not just their general sales where they'll have the weekly deals and the daily deals in between the major events. But the big speculation is that it's related to the Steam refund system, in that the summer sale that they had after Steam refunds came into play, I'm pretty sure that they had a summer sale after that. I really should have went back and double-checked my timing there, but I know that there's been at least one major sale after Steam sales or Steam refund has been put into effect. And the speculation is that they just got so bombarded with refund requests after a game would go on daily deal because nobody followed the chart of check your sales, see if anything, check the games that you want to look at, see if they're on daily deal. If not, wait a day and repeat the cycle until the end of the sale and then buy everything then.
Yep.
Because that was too hard for people.
Well, people are impatient. They're impulsive buyers and shoppers. I mean, that's the nature of Western capitalism.
Yeah, really.
Anyways, carry on.
Well, the speculation is that Steam just got so overburdened with that, which, let's be perfectly frank, I do love my Steam. I'm a member of the PC Gaming Master Race. I do not regard gaming as a god because of the whole paid mods thing that went down a fair while ago. And I can almost hear you rolling your eyes. But Steam support, well,
is garbage.
It's garbage. Well, I was going to say it's sort of like military intelligence. It's an oxymoron.
No, just leave it. It's garbage. That's good enough.
Well, it's contradictory. There's just a complete lack of support, and it's really the downfall of what I think it's holding. I think it's just holding back Steam in general. And I know I'm saying it's holding back the major market for PC gaming right now.
See, let me interrupt you for a second. That is the key point. Steam is the leader, and I mean they're by far and away the leader. I mean there's some other big players in the downloadable market like GOG and GOG.
okay, let's name the big ones. You have Steam, then you have Origin.
Yeah, Origin.
You have Uplay. You have GOG.
I disagree that Uplay is a big player. They are forcing people to use Uplay, yeah. But I mean, I don't know anybody that goes, "Oh, hey guys, I bought this game off Uplay." I've never heard that comment, or never heard or read that comment anywhere before, ever.
Well, I do have a couple games on Uplay, mostly because I got codes for it, and that was really the only place to get it.
Right. Green Man Gaming is up there too. They do a lot of stuff. They're getting bigger. They've got their own client now, so that's. I don't know, that counts for something, I guess. But I mean, Steam is bigger than all of the rest of them put together. And when you're in that market leader position, you're not under any pressure to have good customer service because everybody's already coming to you anyway. So it's like, if I lose one or two because my customer service sucks, big deal. And I mean, as much as we all love Gaben and we all love things that Steam does and all that, they're, above all else, a company for profit.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, we've seen it with other market leaders in the past. Going back to the console cycle or going to the console cycle, Sony's customer support with this generation of consoles has been awful. I mean, there are dozens, maybe hundreds of stories on the internet of where that because Sony's online security is garbage, they've had their accounts hacked and their credit cards stolen and used to buy things on the Play Store. And Sony's like, "Eh, that's tough. We'll refund you, you know, $100. And if you do a chargeback, we'll cancel your account." And they've done that to people, you know?
Yeah, and in 2014, there was a major DDoS attack on both the Xbox and PlayStation online services. Mm-hmm. And they tried it on Steam and brought down one server out of something like 20 some.
Yeah.
And and the kicker is that there's another group threatening this year. We'll find out in a few days if that happens.
Yeah, I saw that on where did I see that on Twitter? I think someone had tweeted about it. I was like, big deal. I play games on PC most of the time.
Well, here's the thing is that, and we're getting completely off topic again.
Right. Finish the thought and we'll go back to Steam sales.
Is that the console online really should be better because you're paying for it.
Yeah.
You're paying, what, $60 a year for the online service?
Yeah, for both services.
That is just amazing to me that they have that level of service. And this is kind of tying into the whole customer service thing of the, it's just so poor that you have ads on a paid service also, which is also just mind-boggling to me.
Yeah, I hate that. That's why I don't use Hulu.
You have ads, you have data breaches, massive data breaches. Was it 2013, 2014, or the Sony one where they found that basically everything was kept in plain text?
Yeah, I think that was 2013. I could be wrong, but I think that's when it was.
Well, remember, I don't really pay attention too much to consoles.
Well, Sony's had like one big breach a year for the last 4 years, so I don't know. It was an older one though.
Yeah, and it just ties into the whole thing of it's a walled garden. You have, this is tying into a topic for later, by the way.
Okay.
You have people basically have to play on your system for a particular game. So they, and to play online, they have to pay you for that. But you really have no inclination to improve your service because you have them. It's the same with Steam. They just aren't improving themselves because they really don't have to because they're two major competitors. I'm not sure if I consider GOG or Green Man Gaming up there because I'm not sure on their numbers. So I'm just going to use the big three downloadable clients that I can think of, at least offhand. There's Dasur as well. I just thought of that one, but that's more of like an indie thing. And they've had some money issues and they may be going away. Who knows there?
Yeah, they've been on the brink for a while now, since sometime back in the summer.
Out of the big three, which I may be completely wrong on their numbers, and the other ones are bigger. Oh, Steam is obviously the biggest, but once again, getting off topic. Out of the three, Steam is the only one that has more than one publisher. Think about this. Origin is mostly EA games.
Right.
Uplay
is... It's all
Ubisoft because no one else wants to put their games on that piece of garbage.
GOG is owned by the people who make
CD Projekt Red.
Yeah, Project Red. There you go.
Yeah, no, sorry. CD Projekt Red is the developer for The Witcher itself, and CD Projekt is the overarching thing.
Okay.
If I recall correctly, at least. But yeah, that's where Steam really has it, is that they brought in the other companies. They didn't make themselves a walled garden.
And even if the other companies leave, Steam is still the poster, I was going to say poster child, but the place to go for the indies. Like, there are so many indie games on Steam compared to published titles or, you know, AAA games or whatever you want to call them, you know?
Yeah, the only place I can think of that is close to, well, even close to it is Dasura, but that's, Dasura has, I don't want to say a quality control problem, but they have a lot of people just dumping things on there and that really shouldn't be sold. I'm not sure if you've ever crawled through the bowels of Dasura, which...
I've crawled through Dasura before.
Yeah, there are some really bad games on there. And it's a lot harder to discover them. And it just feels like they have a lot of policy issues that they need to look at.
Dasura, to me, is like the place where games that failed to get through Steam Greenlight go to die.
Yeah, or the ones that are trying to drum up enough money to hold out until Steam Greenlight goes through, which Steam Greenlight is another topic for another day that, oh, we could talk so much about Steam Greenlight.
We could probably make a whole episode about Steam Greenlight. So, how about them flash sales going away from Steam sales?
Well, like I said, the reason's probably just the glut of service that they were, the customer support that they had to deal with. And it's really a disservice to the gamers. Yes, I know it was a pain to have to check every 8 hours for the flash sales, to check every day for the daily deals. But at the same time, it was putting a lot more on the front page. If the autumn sale that we just had about a month ago now is any indication of what the winter sale is going to be tomorrow, it had a lot less upfront of what was really outside of the major titles out there for sale.
Yeah. Yeah, for the autumn sale, I only looked at my wish list and went, well, is there anything on my wish list that's cheap enough for me?
Well, but, to be fair, I think your wish list has more coverage than anything that they had.
Yeah, my wish list has, it's getting close to 600 games at this point.
Your wish list is almost the size of my library.
I mean, my wish list is basically just a watch list of games that I'm interested in. But, you know, I am interested in all of them, so I, you know, would be okay owning them. But yeah, for the autumn sale, I just looked at my wish list. But for all the flash sales and the daily deals, I do check the daily deals every day. I check the flash sales as much as I can. You know, I would discover things that I hadn't seen before, or I would see something that maybe I had said that I was not interested in, but it had changed, or they just presented it better than it was before, or something like that, and then I'd go, you know what, actually I am interested in this. I will pay you $4 and something for it. But now I'm just going to look at my wish list, which, granted, is huge, but most people don't have wish lists like me. Most people have less than 50 games on their wish list. So that's a lot smaller coverage area, and a lot less developers are going to be found, even with the discovery system. I don't use the discovery system. I just ignore that.
The discovery system is a Band-Aid trying to cover a gaping wound. Because it requires the tagging system for Steam, and Steam is just rife with a lot of trolling.
Yeah. I think I'm sad overall that the flash sales and the daily deals were gone and are probably going to continue to be gone. I think that was, like you said, a good discovery opportunity. And then the second thing is they had all of those fun games that were based around those things, like... the summer sale had the actual kind of clicker game that you could get bonuses for voting on the flash sales and the daily deals and all that stuff. And then before, the trading cards have been tied into that for a while now. Voting gets you trading cards. And now all of that's gone. And so
It's going to be interesting to see what they replace that with, if they have something to replace it with.
Yeah. And to me, that's part of the fun of the sales. It's like, oh, I get to play this little meta game the whole time. And just enjoy myself and feel better about spending money on things. I mean, as a psychologist, which is the ologist part of the our show name, I completely get making people feel good and fixing things and presenting things in a better way to people. And especially when it comes to making purchases, people are a lot more likely to spend money when they're both happy and having fun. And all of those cute little games were fun. That kind of concludes my thoughts on it.
Yeah. I'm just trying to think if there's anything else really to say about it. It is a loss for us, but a win for Steam, which we talked about, is that Steam isn't there to make us feel good. They're there to make a profit.
Right.
So that's likely why we're not going to see it again. Or if we see something, it will be completely different. They really need a better way to navigate the store, and just in general, and the discovery queue isn't pulling its weight on that part. And I have no idea how to fix it.
Yeah. I don't really know if there is a great way to fix it. Having the recommended lists goes some way to fixing it for people like me and you who pay a lot of attention to the gaming industry, because we all have our people that we can follow on Steam. That we tend to agree with.
Oh, you mean the curators?
Yeah, the curators. There you go. I couldn't think of the word, so I just plowed through without it. But the curator system helps. But even then, you know, it's still maybe a bigger Band-Aid, but still a Band-Aid on a much larger problem. Perhaps one day in the future we can brainstorm and try and come up with some of our own ideas on how to fix all of Steam's problems.
Oh, I just fear that the system is just too huge to fix.
It might be. It might be one of those things where what is it that my dad always says? Where the plumbing overtakes the system. It gets too complicated and you just can't keep up with it. We'll see, though.
Yeah, it would be something to talk about in a future day.
You did mention trolls on Steam, though.
Oh, yeah, the Steam reviews.
Yep, that is our next order of business.
Oh, Steam reviews, there's a bell curve for me when it comes to Steam reviews when I look at a game. If there's below a certain point or above a certain point, and it really depends on the genre and just the audience for the game, so there's no set numbers, which makes it even more ambiguous.
Right.
There's either so few reviews that they're practically worthless because it's like the developer's friends or, you know, this one really enthusiastic person that got the game on release.
Right.
It's just those type of people, and the reviews are so skewed that they're practically useless.
Yeah. I almost entirely ignore Steam reviews. If I see a game that has overwhelmingly positive or overwhelmingly negative reviews, I'll peruse through them for a couple minutes just to see what people are saying, mostly because the overwhelming categories can be created by people making joke reviews.
Yeah.
Which I hate and is awful, but with no curation on that, people can do it. Otherwise, if there's a game that I want to buy, I will go and I will find an outside review or two and read those, and then decide from there. Mixed reviews actually is pretty good for the most part, I think. Things that tend to be middle of the road, people will be very honest with. So, you know, reading through some of the positive and the negative reviews can be useful at times. But for the most part, the only two things that I really care about are overwhelmingly positive or overwhelmingly negative.
Well, getting back to my bell curve, the other end of the bell curve is what you talked about. The game gets popular enough that it starts attracting the troll reviewers, you know, the people that make jokes instead of reviews.
Mm-hmm.
And for some reason, Steam is encouraging these people with the funny tag on reviews. And I just don't understand why they're doing this.
But it doesn't help. All it does is put the tag on the review itself. It still shows up in the positive or the negative category.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, at the very least, those shouldn't count at all towards the review scale, which I have seen a chart. I don't know how accurate it was or where it came from, but how they come up with their review ratings. Overwhelmingly positive is anything over 80% positive reviews.
Yeah, it's over 80% because a game that I have was close to, and it's 80% and I think 500 reviews or something like that.
Yeah.
It's a certain plateau of both percentage and number of reviews.
Then mostly positive was between 60 and 80% positive, or for games that have less than 500 reviews or whatever the threshold is. Then mixed is 40 to 60, and then mostly negative is 40 to 20, and overwhelmingly negative is 20 to 0% positive reviews.
Yeah, to give you an idea of the reviews, I went to Grand Theft Auto 5, the reviews. I'm skipping the one friend that's reviewed it because that doesn't really count. $2.2 million for a car. 11 out of 10 would buy shark card, striked out, would find a hacker again. That's 1,080 out of 1,344 people, 80%, has found that review helpful.
And that's not helpful. It's mildly funny. It's clearly a joke, but that's not helpful. All that tells me is that, oh, they have microtransactions. Great.
Yeah, let's see. Next one down. Created my character, went and bought a mask, robbed a store with a pistol that had no ammo. Store clerk noticed the gun was empty, shot me several times. Then I went home and played GTA, and it was pretty great. 11 out of 10.
That one's not really funny. That just kind of gets a sneer.
Yeah, and then the next one down, these are rated the most use or the most helpful reviews, I might add. Most helpful is the loading screen is my favorite part.
Wow. Really helpful there.
Yeah. And these three of those were positive reviews, by the way. Next one down is, oh God, Rockstar is so rich, but adding a decent anti-cheat? No way. We can't create something like that. Negative review. Actually, something that's mildly helpful.
That is mildly helpful, yeah. Not great, but mildly helpful.
And I'm almost off the actual store page before loading more reviews, which is over 35,000 reviews.
Yeah. I mean, that's the problem. There's too much noise with Steam reviews.
It's the same problem as the store itself. It's a noise-to-signal ratio.
If there was some kind of curation for it, be it automatic or somehow, I don't know, moderated.
I think if you have a curation system for it, it has to be a third party. You cannot trust the developer with that type of power.
No, I agree. I'm not saying that the developer should have that power at all. Obviously, they will promote only the most positive reviews. But...
yeah, which there has been developers that have tagged negative reviews as abusive and got them removed from the system to bump up their score. It has happened.
Yeah. I think that there should be... I mean, I've reviewed games before as a professional.
Yeah, I have as well.
You know, if people like us could somehow get credentials where that our reviews would show up at the top of the list or in a separate box that's, I don't know, professional reviews or whatever. I mean, that would encourage me to write reviews on Steam regardless of whether or not I got paid for it. Right now, I don't write reviews because I'm just like, well, what's the point? It doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's partly what the curator system is supposed to be, but you end up with a lot of curators that are just useless.
Yeah.
I ran into one curator that was literally Hordor from Game of Thrones, and every single one of their reviews was Hordor. That was it.
Hordor. That's actually mildly amusing, but not helpful for a review.
Yeah, and it wasn't even like they were going through and trying to tag good games, because I looked at the list and there was some games that were just horrendous on there that was tagged. So it wasn't even, you know, trying to just do some sort of quality assurance as well. It's just literally just, you know, maybe it was just the game that popped up on their store page or whatever.
Yeah, I even doing that, there would still probably be a lot of noise. I mean, there's a lot of professional reviewers out there, but there would be less than 35,000. I'm pretty positive of that. There would be less than 35,000 professional reviews for games. So that would help. That would go a long way, actually. I don't know how you could earn your credentials or how the system would work, but I think that's the best idea I've ever thought of to try and combat that problem.
Yeah, you have a whole vetting problem, and also, who is considered a professional reviewer? I mean, you'll get sites that are trying to push politics in gaming, which is a whole nother issue.
Right.
And a very dangerous one these days. You'll get sites like that that will get their reviewers vetted and be pushing, you know, this game is terrible because it doesn't have enough black people in it, or has too many white people in it, or there's too much water, or whatever.
There's too much water.
That's actually a review. Was it IGN that did that? That they literally said that there was too much water in a game.
All right. I don't really... I guess everybody's entitled to their opinion, even if it's silly. You know, pushing politics... We're about to go off topic again. Pushing politics for reviews is, in my opinion, something that can be done as long as it's done tastefully. I think that games can properly be criticized for not having enough diversity, or conversely, for having too much diversity. But you have to be very careful with that in how you present it. And presenters that do it poorly, which are most of them, that would be where your problem is.
Okay, I had to go find it. It's actual negative point on a review for Pokemon Omega Ruby and Sapphire. It literally says too much water.
Okay. I don't see how that's a valid criticism for that game, but I've never played it, so maybe there is too much water. Not a big Pokemon person.
I haven't played Pokemon since the second generation.
Yeah.
I look at all the new Pokemon and think, what is this?
Yeah, I played Silver and Gold. That was the last.
Same here. That's the second generation.
Yeah.
Back in my day, there was, well, depending on the generation, 151 or 252.
Back in my day, there weren't 550 Pokemon to remember.
What?
Anyways. Yeah. The review system, overall, it's a mess, and it could use some work.
Which we come back to the whole problem of that Steam is the 800-pound gorilla in the gaming industry for PC. There's really no inclination to fix it.
Right. So, bearing that sad, sad prospect
in mind. Yeah, it's a shame that EA is so evil that, you know, I really can't support buying games on Origin. I'll pick up their free games, no problem, but I just can't support them.
They've got great customer service from everything that I've heard.
Yeah, they got great customer service, but it's EA.
Yeah. So, I see our next topic here on the list, video games as a service instead of a product. What? You put that on there. What do you mean by that? I was perplexed.
Well, I'm talking about, it actually ties into a bit of what you were talking about on the mobile market.
Okay.
Is that games aren't treated like a product. They're treated as a delivery system for DLC. They're treated as a delivery system for microtransactions. On one of the streams that we had, we started just ragging on Evolve. And that's a game that they built from the ground up to deliver DLC.
Right.
That's what I mean by that they're not treating it as a product anymore. They're trying to push games as a service to deliver, well, basically to suck money out of your wallet. I mean, let's just be frank. Not saying that games should be free. That started to sound like that, but at the same time, it's getting abusive.
Yeah. Okay, that makes a lot more sense now that you have explained that to me.
Yeah, maybe I should put a little bit more info on that one.
It's okay. Well, how I feel about that is that I think that there is a place for games as service. So, for games that are more about a platform to deliver you things that you pay for. Which, that might sound really awful, but I feel like MMOs are a lot like that. MMOs are, regardless of whether or not you've got the subscription model or the free-to-play kind of microtransaction-based model, MMOs are a platform/service that you pay for all the time. And I think that they are probably the best example of how that works properly. I mean, you pay them a service, or you pay for the game originally up front, at least in the old model, and then you pay them a service fee every month to keep your account running, which pays for their servers and all of that jazz. And then you can buy the little add-ons every now and then so that they can make some more money. I mean, World of Warcraft has done that for years and years and years.
But they're also declining now.
World of Warcraft is on the decline, but 5 million subs is still a lot bigger than any other MMO out there that I'm aware of.
Unless you start throwing things like MOBAs into the mix.
Yes, which we'll get to those. So I think that there's a proper way to do it. I would even say that Evolve did a pretty good job with that. It's just that they marketed themselves so poorly. Like, they made that their focus. Like, I don't know why they thought it would be a good idea, but we are going to be a platform to deliver you DLC and have a cool game in the process. But I mean, people aren't going to buy that. But after Evolve came out and we saw how much was actually in the game from the start that wasn't part of the microtransactions or whatever, they actually delivered a pretty decent game. They just sold it wrong.
Yeah, and the problem is that you have, at least Evolve on PC is practically a ghost town. And the reason for this is that there is just so much competition for shooters on PC that if your game isn't good from the outset, people are going to go away.
Yep. Evolve is a competent shooter, and that's enough on console where there's only maybe a dozen titles like that to play. But on PC, where you've got literally thousands of different first-person shooters you can play, being competent isn't good enough to keep yourself going. I think that it's safe to say that Counter-Strike GO is probably the biggest FPS. It or Team Fortress 2 are probably the biggest ones.
I'm pretty sure Counter-Strike is bigger right now. I could go check the charts.
But, you know, they're great. They're phenomenal games, phenomenal shooters that have communities that help prop the game up. And they don't try to nickel and dime you. Counter-Strike GO a little bit with its crates, but I mean, those are optional.
Yeah, but that's also, you start getting into the price point, and Counter-Strike is by far larger than TF2, about three times the size.
Okay.
Right now, at its peak, it's today, I should say, 78,000 for Team Fortress 2, 600,000 for Counter-Strike.
Okay, but still, 78,000 is probably, I don't know, 70 times more than Evolve has had today.
Yeah, let's just put it this way. Evolve doesn't appear on the top 100.
poor Evolve. But, you know, there's a proper way to have games as service. But, like, another mobile game that I play on my phone, like, it's my toilet game, is Star Wars Commander. It's basically Clash of Clans with a Star Wars theme on it. Every time I open the game, a little thing pops up. Hey, check out the deals. Check out our sales. You know, if you bought premium currency, you could speed along this building process. That is where it goes wrong. That is not the proper way to do games as service. That is just games as exploitative.
Which is kind of tying into a big problem I have with the AAA gaming industry, is that it just feels so exploitative these days that games are being pushed out broken, at least on PC, I should say. Console games tend to be working as intended, but then again, you're kind of coming into the whole walled garden thing again, where it's a set platform. It's not that hard to get a game to run.
It's very clear that you don't play consoles very often anymore. Which, I mean, I know that
there's a difference between run and run well.
It's very clear you don't play consoles very much anymore. I mean, the problems persist on consoles as well. Pushing games out with ridiculous amounts of bugs or unfinished content, even completely broken.
I will admit that my last console I owned was a PlayStation 2.
I own an Xbox One and a Wii U. And then I've owned every console from generations past. So, Xbox One is the worst just because it's the least powered console out of all of them.
Yeah, I've seen some performance comparisons, and it is just laughable, the fact that they can't even push 1080p, let alone hold 30 FPS at times.
Yeah.
That's why I was saying running, but not running well.
Yeah, we've had that conversation, and we should have that conversation again for the podcast, but suffice it to say that that problem persists across all platforms. PC just gets a lot more of it because there's a lot more games on PC compared to everywhere else.
And that PC compounds the problem of it's not a set system. There's just so many different combinations.
Yeah.
And that's not even getting into the whole drivers issue and just different configurations of software. It's literally just the hardware is just can be so vastly different.
Mm-hmm.
It's incredibly hard to develop on PC. In 2014, there was just failure after failure after failure of major games, and even 2015 with the Arkham Knight. It was actually the first AAA game to come out after Steam refunds.
Yeah.
What a timing for that.
Yeah, great timing, though. I mean, otherwise people would have been screwed. There's no way they were going to refund all that. They would have just said, oh, we'll fix it. And they still haven't fixed it.
Yeah, they're still working on that game, supposedly.
Yeah, supposedly. I think that they're just... they're done with it. I think that they're just moving on to the next project with Arkham Knight. You know, we talked about Xbox and PlayStation. I think that's a good segue, unless you have anything else to say.
Not really.
Then, yeah, that's a good segue into platform.
Yeah, you covered pretty much everything I wanted to say about as games as a service.
Me and you, man, we're on the same wavelength.
Oh, my.
Oh. So, platform exclusivity, another topic of yours.
And once again, one that I understand why it's there, but at the same time, it feels so anti-consumer.
Uh-huh.
Is the idea that you could take a game and tie it to a particular system for ever or just a set amount of time, depending on your game, of course, and basically force people into your system because they want to play that game. A really good example of this is actually the latest Tomb Raider game.
Right, with its timed exclusivity to PS4.
No, it's timed exclusivity to Xbox One. And then to PC. It's a double whammy for PS4 owners. And yes, I am a PC gamer, but you know, I kind of feel for the PS4 owners because it's currently out on Xbox One. It's going to come out in, I think, January or February on PC. I don't have the date in front of me. But it's coming out at the end of 2016 on PS4.
Right.
Basically a year. It's just maddening. And the only reason why is because Microsoft gave them a bunch of money to come out on Xbox One first and to screw over the PlayStation 4.
I get why that makes sense as a business decision, but yeah, that's horribly anti-consumer. The only two reasons that I see platform exclusivity being okay, they're very similar, but the only two reasons I see it being okay is, the first is if a company in-house, like Sony or Microsoft, you know, one of their in-house developers develops a game, even though it sucks, I think that that's okay for them to keep it
platform exclusive. Agree with that. That's the Bayonetta 2 model, essentially.
Right, and then that's...
That game wouldn't exist without Nintendo forking over the money, which it feels weird saying Nintendo and Bayonetta 2.
Right, and that was my second example, where that... Because I don't think that the studio that made Bayonetta, like, they were funded by Nintendo, but I don't think Nintendo owned them. Maybe they did. But that was going to be my second example.
I thought that was where you were going with it, was that they were funding it even if they didn't own the developer themselves.
That was where I was going. I was going to say, you know, my other example is that if a studio funds a developer fully, or at least mostly, like, say, 2/3 of their funding comes from one of the platform owners, then I'm also okay with that being a platform exclusive. Otherwise, I don't believe in platform exclusives, and timed exclusives are the worst.
Yeah, and what do you want to bet in, let's say, a year, once the PlayStation 4 version of Tomb Raider's been out for a fair amount of time, which I'm hoping that, you know, it's not, you know, like December 30th for PlayStation 4 owners. I'm not that mean. What do you want to bet that Squaresoft is going to say that Tomb Raider, or Rise of the Tomb Raider, I think it is, had disappointing sales?
Oh, I'm sure they will. They did that with the last one.
Yeah.
They had 6 million copies sold when they made that announcement. And it's like 6 million copies, if that's disappointing? I think you need to rethink your definition of that.
Well, I saw a more defined what they meant by that. They wanted more sales on the opening week, essentially. They want the that big, fat initial sale. But at least for PC, I have no idea how it is for consoles. It probably isn't for consoles. Sales on PC is a long tail. It's a long, long process. I mean, just look at Skyrim, for example.
Yeah,
Skyrim is how old? And it still sits in the top of sales, and especially during big holiday sales.
Yep. It came out in 2011. So that makes Skyrim 4 years old at this point.
Yeah, I'm taking a quick look to see if it's on the front page, and I'm not seeing it, which is actually a first for quite a while. Well, Counter-Strike Go is on the top, and that's pretty old as well.
Yeah. I don't know how it works on consoles as much. I mean, I've played plenty of console games, but to be honest, I used to buy a lot of console games used, and then I got a job and made money, so I started buying them new. But even then, I wouldn't buy them at launch. I've always waited.
I found Skyrim. Sorry to butt in.
That's okay.
Skyrim is 27th currently being sold on Steam.
I mean, that's high. Steam's got like 6,000 titles on it. So 27 is very high.
And this is also, if I recall correctly, Steam also ranks this by revenue and not number of sales. So their Witcher 3, which is just above it, is $60, while Skyrim Legendary Edition, which is the entry I found on here, is 40. And they're keeping up with them.
Yeah. And that game's 4 years old, and Witcher's not even a year old. Or Witcher 3, I should say.
Yeah, sorry to butt in.
No, it's fine. But I mean, I always bought games after release. I waited for sales. I would read reviews and stuff like that. I think consoles get a bigger burst on launch than PC does. I'm not exactly sure why. If I was to speculate, I'd say it would be the combination of the fact that there's a lot less games on console compared to PC, and the PC or the console player tends to be someone who spends less time in the video game market, or in the, I guess, the video game world, reading news and that sort of thing. So they see a commercial on TV or something like that, that they, for a game they really want.
They go, ooh, shiny.
Yeah, and they go buy it. And that's not to
probably
say
that... Probably explains Battlefront's numbers. Sorry.
Star Wars explains Battlefront's numbers.
Well, I have something later that I think will amuse you.
Okay. So, I don't know. I don't know exactly what makes consoles better or worse for kind of burst sales, but I think that's why. I mean, that's my guess at least.
Yeah, it always came off that consoles is more... now, I should preface this once again, that saying I haven't owned a modern console, so it's once again an outsider looking in, that consoles are more flavor of the month or flavor of the week, with players sticking around on certain titles because there's really no other good option. Call of Duty, refusing Counter-Strike and Call of Duty, I'm going to get some hate for that. Why Call of Duty is so popular is that people are riding that wave of the flavor of the year for Call of Duty, and there's really no really good alternatives for that style of gameplay.
Right. Because Call of Duty's competitors, at least in the console market, are Battlefield and... Is that it? And Battlefield and Call of Duty are very different games, so... I suppose Call of Duty will get some competition from Battlefront, because Battlefront's more like Call of Duty than Battlefield. Titanfall was a bit more Call of Duty-esque. Evolve was really like neither. So yeah, totally agree with you on that one.
Yeah, on PC, I could think of Dirty Bomb immediately as a free-to-play alternative for Call of Duty.
Oh, Dirty Bomb's great. I love Dirty Bomb. That's probably the best free-to-play shooter I've ever played.
I would throw TF2 out there, but then again, TF2 has done some things lately that I don't agree with.
Well, TF2 is also, I guess it is
a very different game.
Yeah. I was going to say it is a first-person shooter, but it's an extremely different game to Dirty Bomb and a lot of other.
Yeah, it's really amazing just how different those games are while they're in the same genre. Do we have anything more to say about console exclusivity or platform exclusivity, I should say?
I don't think so. I got all my thoughts out. So, moving on from platform exclusivity, I see the next topic is MOBAs. What do you want to talk to me about MOBAs?
Another genre, or another one of mine. Have you ever played MOBAs?
I have played MOBAs, and they are not for me. I've tried Smite, I've tried League of Legends, and I've tried Dota 2. So, the big ones. I've also tried Heroes, what is it, Heroes of the Storm? The Blizzard one?
Yeah, I haven't tried Blizzard's Heroes of the Storm. I played a bit of League of Legends. I played Smite. Then I played some of the little indie ones like Awesome Knots. Have you ever heard of that one?
Yeah, I've seen Awesome Knots. It's 2D, right?
Yeah, it's more of a platformer / MOBA than a straight up MOBA.
Right.
Yeah, it's getting into the whole kind of meshing together genres, sort of like how Smite does it with. It's more of a third person shooter than. What League of Legends is or Dota.
Right. All right. Before we go any further, let me just say something. The main problem I have with most MOBAs is that I do not like isometric kind of top-down views. Something about that has never jived with me. And it's not just MOBAs that I don't like. A lot of ARPGs have got top-down isometric views. And... You know, other games have done that. RTS is probably the only game that I like with the top-down view. So it's not necessarily MOBAs that I don't like. It's the fact that most MOBAs are designed in that style. I do like MOBA elements in, like, first-person shooters and in RPGs, but not the actual, like, what most people consider MOBAs. I don't like those because of the top-down isometric view.
Just control-wise in general, or just the whole style?
The whole style. I don't... It's really hard to explain why it doesn't jive with me. It just... It feels odd, if that makes sense. If I could control the camera a bit more, I think I would be okay with it, but in...
It's hard to feel like you're lining up something.
Right. It just feels off. That's actually probably the best way I've ever heard it said.
Well, my problem with MOBAs isn't the gameplay itself, even though it is a little jarring if you're not used to an ARPG style. It's the community.
MOBA communities are notoriously toxic, and that's being polite.
Yeah, League of Legends is notable on just how terrible their community is to one another. To the point where you go on the subreddit and it's like watching dogs fighting. It's a hard genre to really sit down and learn if you're not going in with someone. And I think that's partly comes from the pressure of competition, where you're playing the same match for, let's say, an hour is like the standard match for a MOBA. I know it changes from game to game, especially some of the smaller MOBAs are like 15, 20 minutes, but let's just call it an hour for a match.
Yeah.
And MOBAs are designed around a way where it's a lot harder to push back than it is to push in. Sure, you can make reversals, you can make come from behind victories, but at the same time, it's a lot more difficult than getting that initial lead. So there's this huge, huge pressure to not screw up.
Right.
And for a newbie, for someone that doesn't know that, when to retreat, doesn't know all the heroes, especially with League of Legends, which has, well over 100 now? Probably like 150?
There's a lot. And they do the hero rotation if you play for free.
Yeah, and there's no way you'll know all those heroes unless you are just no-lifing that game. Let's be perfectly honest.
Right.
So there's no way to know that all that hero can knock a third of your health off and stun you. And there's no way that you're going to get away because they're just going to chain stun you with their different abilities. And losing a match because you didn't know, and then getting your team to dogpile on you because they blame you for that loss, which could or could be your fault. Who knows? There is times that I played a MOBA and was just blamed for something that maybe I was out of position. It could have been my fault. I'm not saying that I'm completely innocent. But at the same time, there's been times that I have no idea why they're yelling at me. Just having... are you okay with
no,
that?
I was thinking.
Uh-oh.
Go ahead, finish your thought.
You're getting psychological on me, aren't
you? I am.
Oh, boy. You have that intense pressure, and it just turns people against one another. And it's just a genre that I've found myself reluctant to play, even with friends, because of just how tense the situation is, how it just makes it... I'm trying to think the proper way to put it. It just... Well, toxic is the best word for it, really.
A lot of MOBAs suffer, and I'm not sure why MOBAs specifically so heavily suffer from mob mentality, but you are absolutely correct. One person does something not even seriously wrong, like maybe you just accidentally missed a cooldown. You know, you were off on your timing by a couple of seconds.
Or you missed a kill because your ability was ready.
Right. Things that probably aren't your fault or are so minute that they probably don't make that much of a difference anyways. One kill absolutely can make the difference in a game, but that happens a lot less than people like to discuss. Really, that only happens in high-level play. But someone will just jump on top of you. Like, the person who was standing next to you in your lane. Oh, you messed up your cooldown. You suck and you're horrible and you should go kill yourself, which... That in itself is gross overuse of, I don't know, just putting too much anger and negativity into a person over a video game. But then, like, someone sees that in chat, and they're like, oh, I guess this guy screwed up. I better yell at him, too. And then the other person's like, oh, I guess he screwed up. And, you know, depending on your MOBA, your team sizes vary, but, you know. Let's just call it five. Five's pretty standard. So now four out of the five people are yelling at this one person for something that really wasn't that big of a deal, won't do much to change the outcome of the game. But once that starts, it's over. Mob mentality kicks in, and they spend the rest of the game either picking on this one person or just yelling at each other.
And the thing is that also, because they're focusing on this one person, they're not paying much attention to the game anymore.
Right, which just causes...
So it's amplifying that mistake.
Yep, it causes a downward spiral. And particularly in MOBAs that have long match times, once you get past the 20 or 30 minute mark, a lot of times you can see which side is going to win and the other side is fighting a losing battle. And you start to have players who will either just quit or go AFK or something because they see that
they're... Or intentionally feed.
Yeah, so that they speed the process along and can get to their next
match. Well, I should say feeding is... in MOBAs, the enemy team is rewarded for killing a player of your team. So they'll just run in intentionally and get themselves killed over and over again to boost up the enemy team to make the process go faster.
Right. And once those things start happening, that mob mentality just gets worse and worse and worse until the game ends. And it doesn't happen in every game, but it happens a lot. And I don't know why MOBAs are so toxic. I don't know why they draw that. I mean, online multiplayer gaming tends to be pretty rough anyways. People, because of the anonymity that comes from being online, people tend to not filter out their worse thoughts.
Yeah, it reminds me of a Penny Arcade comic from years and years ago. Anonymity plus video games equals asshole.
That is true a lot of times, sadly. I don't have a good answer, and I don't have a solution. I don't really know if there's a way to fix it. A lot of times in those games, you need the chat in order to be able to coordinate. I think... go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to say, I will say that out of the major players being... Well, we'll call it four major players. Smite, League of Legends, Dota, and Heroes of the Storm. From what I've seen, Smite is the kindest of them, but it also has the shortest match time. So maybe it has a time between... there's some sort of correlation between match time and what people are willing to put up with.
Yeah. Heroes of the Storm has got a pretty good community, too. But Heroes of the Storm is the most forgiving of the ones that you've listed. So it's a lot less competitive, a lot less serious. I mean, high-level play is possible, but I've heard many people say it's the easiest MOBA to jump into if you want to try and learn a MOBA. But League of Legends and Smite are both hyper-competitive, huge communities. You know, they're the MOBAs that everyone thinks about, either LOL or Dota 2. Probably it's also a community-sized thing. Their communities are so much bigger. There's a lot more chance for assholes to be there and blossom.
Possibly also related just to matchmaking. The people that get that angry, generalists don't focus on the game afterwards, and then they just don't progress up the rankings.
Right, that's true. There could be less problems with that in high-level play. I don't know, I'm purely speculating at this point. I've played League of Legends for maybe 4 hours, Dota 2 for
I played League for a bit longer. Part of the reason why I brought this up as a topic was also that League of Legends Riot was bought out by a Chinese company, and I'm blanking on the name, but it's the same one that actually owns Heroes of New Earth.
I have no idea. None.
They've stated one of their goals outside of making the game more accessible, adding a bunch of crafting things and a lot more social stuff, is to try to clean up the community.
Good luck with that.
Riot has been trying that for years now.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if they could do it. Granted, Heroes of New Earth, I don't think it's as bad, but then again, it's also a far smaller game. League of Legends is probably the biggest PC game out there. Only one that I would imagine that would even come close would be something like Minecraft.
Mm-hmm.
Things that we don't have official numbers on. I mean, I could look at Steam chart or Steam stats or the Steam things, and just it will give me precise numbers on games from Steam, but these games aren't on Steam, so it's really hard to pin down a number, and you only have the marketing thing saying that there's 10 million accounts for League of Legends, but that doesn't really say how many active accounts there are.
Right.
And I'm just pulling 10 million out of them.
I'm pretty sure it's a lot higher than 10 million.
Yeah, it's probably something like 15 or 20, but then again, you also still get into the thing of, okay, how many of those are active? How many of those are at peak? You know, that sort of thing.
That's true. I have an account with League of Legends, and it's not been active for like 2 years, so.
Yeah, same here. Yeah, we're just coming with all the topics that we have problems with. We really don't know the solution, and I'm not sure if there is a solution.
Like you've said before, the only winning move is not to play.
Gotta love war games.
Indeed. So we've been talking about all these MOBAs. They're multiplayer games. Next thing on the list is the price of multiplayer-only games.
Is $60 too much for multiplayer-only? This is a topic that I've seen kicked around a lot very recently, partly because of Battlefront.
Yep.
Being kind of Let's be perfectly frank here. It's a pretty thing to look at. But content-wise, there have been a lot of complaints, at least on the PC side of things. Once again, PC is where I've been focusing, so it could be different on consoles.
It's all face and no trousers.
Oh my.
It has done a lot better on consoles, but we run into the problem of, well, there's not as many shooters on consoles, so...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which I actually have numbers later.
Yes and no. I think it depends. If you're going to say, let's use Call of Duty, or let's use Halo for an example. Halo has been known for years for its story content. Halo 5, not so much, but we won't spend too much time getting hung up on that. If they released a Halo game that was multiplayer only, with how much of an emphasis of the Halo franchise has been on the story portion, I would say no, that's too much. I would pay 30, maybe even $40 for Halo multiplayer only, and really I'd only pay that much because it's Halo. However, if you are going to design a game, say Titanfall or Evolve, from the ground up to be multiplayer only, and you put the time and the effort into it to make it the best multiplayer game that you can, then I'm perfectly okay with paying $60 for a multiplayer game. The thing is that with Battlefront and a lot of other multiplayer-only games that have been coming out the last couple of years, they don't do that. They put a lot of time into making a pretty game, but they don't make a game that plays well. And if it doesn't play well, well, then I'm not going to pay for it, because I don't care what games look like.
To be fair, Battlefront isn't a $60 game.
No, Battlefront is a $110 game, plus tax.
Yeah, gotta remember the tax.
Plus, you know...
And that's really start where you run into the thing of, is it a $60 game, because they are putting in the season passes now and heavily pushing them, I might add, for these multiplayer games. And if you don't have the season pass, a lot of times they split up the community based on map packs or the season packs or whatever you want to call it. So if you're not paying in the extra money, you're getting a less of a game, not just feature-wise, but community-wise, because everyone's playing on, you know, help me out with the map pack here. Nuketown, is that one for Call of Duty that was a map pack only recently?
Yeah, it was in one of the Call of Duties, and it did not make it into the next one. And then they released it as DLC because people wanted it.
Yeah, so I have no idea if Call of Duty splits up their community like that, or I'm assuming that they do if they're selling maps like that.
Yeah. Very few multiplayer-only games, which this is a problem, but very few of them actually release maps for free. Halo, Call of Duty, I don't know if Battlefield gets maps. I'm sure they do. I'm not a big Battlefield player. Battlefront, you get maps that come with it, and then all the other maps you have to buy.
And if you don't have those map packs, you are out of luck if you want to play with your buddies who have them and get in the rotation, which how does the matchmaking work? Does it have it where it cycles through and you're basically kicked from the server if you don't have the map? Or this is me showing my greenness on modern console games.
The way they have it, at least with games that I have played recently, I'm not sure about Battlefront or, you know, this year's batch of shooters, but they have the kind of the initial matchmaker, and then a map pack comes out and it gets its own matchmaker, and then another map pack comes out and it gets its own matchmaker, and then when they start releasing map packs, there's a matchmaker that's if you have all of the DLC, everything is in the rotation.
So you're fragmenting your community across that way.
Right. I mean, that's how it's worked with every Call of Duty game I've ever played. And I've played Advanced Warfare. I have not played Black Ops 3, but that's how Advanced Warfare worked as well.
Yeah, it reminds me, there was a PC game, Section 8 Prejudice.
Mm-hmm. Familiar with that game?
You actually know mm-hmm. that one. Impressive.
I own that game.
Oh, my. I think the multiplayer servers are dead now because of Games from Windows Live, but that's another subject for another day, possibly. Towards the end of its lifespan, it was actually impossible for me to play a game of it, because everyone was in the map pack servers, which I would say at the time there was maybe 200 players. And I was unwilling to spend, I think it was $10 or something like that, just to get a couple of maps. It was very small map packs, if I recall correctly. I'm going to have to go double check that. There was it was just requiring you to pay so much to get into those servers that it fragmented what little community that game had. And essentially, it was the final nail in the coffin.
Right. There's a cycle, like a death spiral, that multiplayer-only games go into. And it's, you fragment your community, then people get upset because they can't play games with their friends, or even just like randomly get into games because the community's smaller. So people leave. And then they release more maps and more things, hoping that people will buy them and come back in. But people don't. And so you fragment your community again, and then the people who are willing to stick it out, now they might be pushed over. Well, no one's playing, so I might as well move on. And this just happens and happens. You know, no one wants to play the game because there's no players, but no players are playing the game because there's no players.
Yeah, and then you get in a situation where I am, where I'm seeing, you know, the handful of a few players that are left, and I'm having to pay essentially for the game all over again just to continue playing, and there's just, to me, really no point at that point.
Right. Especially on PC, because you can just move on to another game that has a multiplayer scene.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it varies from game to game. I think most of the time, at least with what we've been given so far, $60 is too much. A good price for a multiplayer-only game is $20 to $30, I think.
Yeah, so more of the Rocket League and less of the Call of Duty, which is unfair because Call of Duty technically has a single-player campaign.
Right. I've said it before, and I'll keep saying it. I only play Call of Duty for the single-player content nowadays. I'm one of those people.
One of those people.
Yeah. But, you know, there are games out there that could deserve it, and I don't think that a game has been presented yet that has what it takes to be sold for $60, but it could happen. I believe that it could happen, and especially with, as the internet continues to become more and more accessible worldwide and speeds are generally on the rise, that it will happen eventually.
Do you think possibly the push for prettier pictures has really hurt the content of these FPSs?
Yes, it has. You don't even have to finish the question. Yes. People's push for higher graphical fidelity has hurt the games industry in ways that probably we don't even realize, despite the fact that we are so knowledgeable on these topics.
Wait, we're knowledgeable?
Yes, we're knowledgeable. I'm going to give us credit for that. I'm an expert. I'm a therapist. So we're knowledgeable. But I mean, just look at consoles. Here we go down a rabbit trail again, but just look at consoles. I mean, so many games can't even run at 30 FPS on consoles that have enough power to do so if people would just turn down the graphical fidelity and focus on making good gameplay and games that run properly.
They can't even run 1080p.
No, they can't. And I mean, you can run a game at 1080p, 60 FPS, and just turn your graphics down. I do it all the time with games on my PC because I'd rather have a higher frame rate than pretty pictures. And honestly, the pictures are still really pretty when you turn off all of the fancy effects. And another thing, I'm on my soapbox now, another thing, if you want a game to look as beautiful as it can be, why are you playing on a console? I don't have anything against consoles. I think that they're a very good thing for the gaming market. There's a lot of people who don't have the time or the knowledge to put into building and maintaining a PC. But if you really want the prettiest games on the market, go buy a PC. I mean, it's night and day on games like Fallout 4, Call of Duty. I almost said Halo, but Halo's not on PC.
Yeah, damn you, Microsoft. Yeah, but even though I'm getting back to the platform exclusivity, that's the reason why it's not on Windows is that it is literally the only thing selling Xboxes, isn't it?
Pretty much, yeah. I can't think of any other Xbox exclusive that has churned out more consoles than Halo. And Halo's not even that great right now. Halo 5 was...
Oh boy, now you're going to get the hate.
Halo 5 was a massive step back from Halo 4.
Master Chief Collection.
Well, the Master Chief Collection just has broken multiplayer.
I actually lost a friend over the Master Chief Collection. He was trying to push me so much into getting a Xbox to play that game. Now, mind you, me trying to play a shooter on a gamepad just doesn't work a lot of the times. I have the muscle memory too much for mouse and keyboard. So I told him, no, I'm not interested in it. He just kept dragging me, talking about how the Master Chief Collection is going to be the greatest thing ever, blah, blah, blah. And then it came out.
Yeah.
And then it was my turn.
Yeah.
And I didn't even say that much to him. I said, so how's the Master Chief Collection? And he blocked me.
I enjoyed the Master Chief Collection, but I have never touched multiplayer on it. I played through all of the old Halo games in 1080p, 60fps, and loved it, and then put it away. I'm not a huge multiplayer guy, honestly. I mean, we've got Warframe that we play, and I play a few other multiplayer games, but mostly I'm a single-player guy. So that problem did not affect me. It was still a problem, an awful thing that shouldn't be ignored, but it didn't really bother me all that much. So the winter sale is coming up, starting tomorrow, although if you're listening to this, the winter sale is already going on. Both of us came up with some games that we want to purchase on the sale if the price is right.
Yeah, this is our wish list picks.
Yep, I had a really hard time with this since I have like 600 games on my wish list, but I did it.
Well, my wish list is not nearly that big, but it's still fairly extensive. So, Jared, you go first since I've been kind of hogging the microphone lately. Okay,
the first one on my list is Bladestorm Nightmare. The Bladestorm series came out originally on Xbox 360. I'm not sure if it made it to PS3. It's basically mostly a clone of Dynasty Warriors, but instead of being in China, it's set in Europe. So you've got different looks to your units and things like that. And then it has a squad system where that you can command troops to follow you and form a squad that you can go and attack and do things with. Nightmare is the next game in the series. It's basically a reskin of the original, honestly, with some kind of magic-y things put in there, like there's creatures and things like that. I'm not sure if there's an actual magic system, it's not talked about, but I love that game, and it has never been on sale before on Steam. It's always at like 40 or 50 bucks, and I just keep hoping that this year's the year, because it scratches a lot of my itches. It's got RPG elements, it's got a crafting system, it's got squad-based control, it's got a great flushed-out single-player story. Pretty much everything that I desire in a game.
Okay, should I take one of mine then?
We'll just take turns.
Okay. At the time of recording, Fallout 4 has been out for quite a while. And with the Fallout fever, I decided that I wanted to go with the Stalker series for one of my picks.
Okay.
Stalker is a from everything that I could tell, this is my games are ones that I'm interested in, but whenever I'm interested in a game like the Stalker series, I don't read too much into it to avoid spoilers.
Right.
But I have looked at it a little bit, and it seems to be basically like a hardcore version of the Fallout 3 New Vegas style, where you don't have the management from Fallout 4, you don't have the colorful world. It's very dark and dingy. It's a lot more dangerous. I'm not sure Fallout 4 is as dangerous. And it supposedly has some of the more impressive AI that is out there in a game, where bandits or groups will move around and they'll attack one another. It's supposed to be really interesting. Like I said, this is one that I've have the least knowledge of based off of the three picks I have.
Okay.
But it's the one that I'm probably most interested in. And I just wanted to try to get into the Fallout fever, but I'm not quite ready to dive into Fallout 4, partly because the whole season pass is out there, but we don't even know what's going to be, let alone good.
Right.
Even though Fallout has had a history of, I should say it has a history of having one really good expansion pack, one really crap expansion pack, and usually one or two decent. And I'm just don't want to hit Fallout 4 yet until I know that the good one is at least out.
Right.
So for me, it's Stalker.
Okay. I've never heard of Stalker, so
it's supposed to be really good. Like I said, it's a lot more dingy. how Fallout has that whole retro futurism style.
Right.
It's not as of a colorful game. It doesn't have the character there, which is probably why it didn't take off like the other ones did, even though there are three games in the Stalker series.
Yeah, I see that. I just looked up Stalker right now.
Yeah, and it's an acronym, so I'm not even sure what Stalker means completely. It may be a story thing.
Yeah, I'm not sure. It doesn't say right up here on the top, and I don't want to spend too much time looking for it.
But it does look very Falloutish, doesn't it?
It does, yeah. Well, it looks like there's some fantasy elements in it. Maybe that's the wrong word. Just it looks like in the picture, this guy looks like a demon or something. I don't know. It could just be a monster.
Yeah.
Next on my list is City Skylines. I actually...
Didn't you try this one before?
The problem that I had was that it didn't run on my machine. There's been a couple of bug fixing patches from when I tried it last time. And also, I had a problem on my PC that I got sorted out that was preventing another couple of games from working. So I'm hoping that that was the main problem. I paid, I think, $15 for it last time. I'd love to get it cheaper than that, but... I mean, I'm more than happy to pay $15 for it. It again is another game that scratches all of my itches. I love management games and city building, and City Skylines the City series has taken the reins from SimCity.
Yeah, the latest SimCity was just so much of a disappointment. Sorry to cut in.
No, it's fine.
I just wanted to throw that out there.
Yeah, I agree. But you know, it's taken the reins from SimCity. So I'm really interested in playing it. I've read tons of reviews and watched tons of stuff on it, so I know I'll like it. It just has to work for me.
Okay, I'm thinking it's my turn
again.
It is
your turn again.
Anyone that knows me knows that I love my roguelikes and roguelites. Uh-huh. And there's one that I've been interested in, but I haven't been able to really pull the trigger on. Sunless Sea, which is technically a roguelike.
I love Sunless Sea. I think my Steam account says I've played it for like 2 hours, but that's not true. I played it on a trip last year to a place that I didn't have internet. I've probably put 30 or 40 hours into that game.
You're making it move up my list.
Sunless Sea is so good. I'm not a huge fan of roguelikes or roguelite, however you like to classify those.
Well, generally, we'll get into the classification a little bit. Generally, roguelike has a very, very narrow definition. It's a dungeon crawler, turn-based, random procedural generation, usually with potions or some sort of other thing that also is randomly generated, and you have a set goal in the dungeon.
Okay.
Roguelite takes elements of that. It could be the procedural generation. It could be the dungeon crawler aspect of it. And it takes one of those and mixes it with another genre, like Binding of Isaac, the roguelike that I play just obsessively for some reason.
Right.
It's technically a roguelike because it has the dungeon element and has the final destination and the procedural generation down, but it's a twin stick shooter mixed in. Mm-hmm. That's the. I know it's splitting hairs big time, but that is the. That's where I put the dividing line, at least.
Right. Well, Sunless Sea is amazing. It's just as long as you're okay with reading, there are novels worth, like multiple novels worth of text in that game. But there's so much story and so much character development, and it's lovely. I love it.
Yeah, it's one of those games I want to just sit down. Set up my notebook, lay in bed, and just go around in with Steam streaming.
Yeah, it's not very intensive. It plays perfectly on my garbage laptop.
It may work on my notebook natively, but you know, I always plan on Steam streaming because it's the more viable option for most of the time.
Right. I'm looking for a game on my Steam list while we're sitting here talking that I can't think of the name of, but I own it. It is a. Do you like puzzle, like kind of match three type games?
I could take or leave it, I should say.
It's a steampunk mech roguelike puzzle game.
I know what you're talking about, but I'm blanking on the name of it. I think Total Biscuit did a video on
it. He did, yeah. That's where I discovered it, and then I had to go buy it because it was another game that was right up my alley. I love puzzle games, match three games, things like that.
Iron Cast,
that is it.
I am a searching god.
You are. Yeah, Iron Cast is... If you like puzzle games and then you like roguelikes, I mean, it is right up your alley.
Yeah, that's sort of like the FTL meets a match three puzzler. Yeah,
it's great. Yep, that's all I have to say about that. It's awesome. Anyways.
Yeah, even though I didn't really say too much about Sunless Sea, because you have the experience with it.
I own and have played Sunless Sea. So, the last game on my list is technically a genre. I don't exactly know what you would call it, but have you ever heard of the games that are the choice of whatever?
All the novels, the adventure novels? Yeah, I've seen those pop up on Steam fairly regularly recently.
Yeah, they're not very expensive. They're usually like between $3 and $5, but I would still love to get a bunch of those on sale. I own... Let's see, let me look here on my phone. I play these on my phone all the time.
Yeah, I was playing with you last night when I saw you fire up one.
Let's see, I've got the entire Hero series. These are all made by one developer. The entire Hero series, which is three, like a trilogy about being a superhero. I've got Mecha Ace, which is a choose-your-own-adventure about being a mech pilot. And then I don't have any others installed. But I've played a couple others. There's one about being a pirate. I think it's called Choice of Pirates. I've played one about kind of a Romeo and Juliet story. It's called Choice of Lovers. They've started getting better with their names, though. The most recent one that I purchased on Steam is called Metahuman Inc., which is a story about being a corporate guy. You get picked as the new CEO of a company, and your company, to avoid spoilers in case anyone that's listening is interested in these games, your company has got some really special connections, and have to decide how to change the fate of your company to save it from bankruptcy after something bad happened to it. And it's got some very, very in-depth... It's their newest one, and it shows that they've had a lot of practice with this. There's so many stats to keep up with and things to manage.
So I always thought it was more just a choose-your-own-adventure thing. It's actually more gamey than I thought it was.
The older ones are pretty much just choose-your-own-adventure. But...
Is there like an instant stealth fail state in a lot of these where you go to the right instead of the left and you fall down, break your leg, and die of hyperthermia?
Not so much. In the older ones, yeah. Like in Mecha Ace, there's a couple of scenarios every chapter where there's like three decisions, and it's like one decision is like, perfect, you did the right thing. And the other one is like, well, you could have done better, but you're okay. And then like you pick the worst one. It's like, oh, you died. You got killed in a big explosion. But they have gotten farther and farther away from that. There are still those hilarious choose your own adventure instant deaths that can happen, but now it's more of a more in line with like a text version of a Telltale game. Honestly, you have stats that you build up, and they vary depending on which game it is. For example, in Metahuman, all of your stats are based on your company, so your company image is a stat that you have, and the products that your company makes, you can use some of them, and they affect your stats. And then you have your own personal stats as a CEO, like, are you a ruthless guy, or are you charitable? And then all of those stats have outcomes based on situations you can encounter, like dealing with media, or in negotiating business deals. I did die, though, last night. I just did something wrong, and I got killed.
If you were a different type of CEO, if you were more Trump-like, would you have continued on in the story with that same choice?
Probably. I'm not a very ruthless businessman. My business character is much more shrewd and plays things real close to the chest and does things a lot behind the scenes. And I wound up in a situation where I was facing down a person who wanted to harm me. And so I didn't have good skills for dealing with someone like that. And I said all the wrong things, and he killed me. And I had to go back and restart the chapter.
That actually sounds a lot more interesting than I thought those novels
were.
They're
really fun.
I'm not one of these that are saying that, oh, they have no place on Steam, because you see so many people saying that on those message boards. I'm not sure if you poked around them. I did take a look at the discussions when I found like one of the first ones that I saw. Probably not the first one that got put on Steam. But it was just so ruthless. The people were saying, this isn't a game, this doesn't belong on Steam, blah, blah, blah. And I had no idea it was so gamey. Not to make that sound like a bad term.
A good one to start with, if you're interested, is Heroes Rise Prodigy. That's the first game in the Heroes trilogy, and that was the one where they really started to break away from the traditional choose-your-own-adventure. And the farther you get into that trilogy, the more complex and game-like they become. Plus, you get to create your own superhero. That's pretty cool.
Can I kill things in one punch?
Yes, actually you can. Towards the end, as you become even more powerful, you can start killing people. Although I played that as an actual hero, you might be able to kill people a lot sooner if you play more of a villain. Which you can do. You can play as a hero, you can play as a villain, you can play as both.
Yeah, sounds interesting. I'll have to keep an eye out for it.
And they don't suffer too much from that telltale your decisions don't matter thing.
Oh, I hate that
there
so much.
There are some of...
Where you're given... I want to give like an example of that. Is that... in The Walking Dead, which I actually never finished because I just found myself not caring anymore.
Right.
I think it was like the third episode where you were supposed to divvy up food.
Uh-huh.
I tried a couple different scenarios and I found nothing that mattered outside of just some dialogue.
Right.
And to me, when they say that your choices matter in a game, it should have consequences, good or bad. It shouldn't be, well, hey, I see you took care of the kids. I like that. So-and-so will remember this decision, blah, blah. It just feels so cheap.
Right. No, there are some of those moments in these games for sure. I've, going back in multiple playthroughs, but they tend to be kind of points where that the story doesn't make sense if it doesn't play out that way. I mean, I've played the Heroes Rise trilogy twice now, once as a hero and once as a villain. And aside from kind of some of the really main story parts that get you through the narrative, they are extremely different playthroughs. Really, like, vastly different. Being a villain's a lot more fun, but nobody likes you.
Well, you're a villain. Who likes the bad guy?
The other bad guys, I guess.
Not true.
But, so yeah, that's my third pick.
Okay, my third pick is an entry in the builder puzzle game genre. Big Pharma.
Oh, I'm familiar with that. It's on my wish list. I actually almost picked
what?
It.
What is it on your wish
list? I actually almost picked Big Pharma, but then I went, I think I want the Choose Your Own Adventure games.
Wow, we almost matched.
We almost got one.
Well, you already know Big Pharma, but I'll go over it anyway. It's essentially a factory simulator where you're building different prescription drugs. What looks like a little bit of business management mixed in as well. And I kind of have a soft spot for management games.
Right. As do I.
And looking at it, it reminded me of one of my actually favorite puzzle games, Space Chem. Have you ever heard of
that one? Yes, I have heard of Space Chem. I don't think I've ever played it, but I've seen it.
Yeah, Space Chem, if you look at it, it's very confusing. But what it essentially is you're building a program to build a particular molecule through either one factory or a series of them. And Big Pharma is essentially the same thing, only instead of working with these imaginary things that can manipulate things on a molecular level, you're working with assembly lines.
Right.
And it just seems very interesting to me, but the price seemed a little high for what it is. If I recall correctly, I think it's like 20 or 25 bucks. I'd have to actually go back and double check. I should have marked these prices
down. Yeah, Big Pharma's 25.
Yeah, and that seems a little high for a puzzle game like that. Especially puzzle games tend to fall into a problem of they can hit a wall where they're asking too much for of you.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't want to pull the trigger on that and hit a wall like that and just be frustrated with it.
Yeah, I think I'd be happy to pay $5, maybe $10 for Big Pharma.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm pretty much happy to pay $5 for almost any game. Like I said, that's my throwaway cash number. It's like, oh, that looks interesting. I'll pay $5 for that.
Oh, no. There's a few games that I don't think I would pay $5 for, but those are really, really bad
games.
That's
true. Yeah. So that's your list and my list?
Yeah.
Anything else you want to say about that?
Not really. It's like I said, it's a very interesting looking game, and it scratches the itches.
Right. Yep. That's what a lot of my games have been, scratching the itch. Well, given that that's the last topic on the list for this week, you want to wrap us up?
Well, don't we have what's more popular than Evolve, or just kicking Evolve while it's down?
Well, we kind of kicked Evolve while it was down earlier, and...
Well, I found something interesting on researching this that I wanted to share,
okay,
at least.
Go ahead.
We were talking about Battlefront a while back and in this episode, and I found that Battlefront 2 is actually having a very big rally on Steam, player-wise. They have over 2,000 players playing that game right now.
Wow.
And that game is how old?
It came out in, I think, 2005?
It is just an ancient, ancient game. So, seeing that, I decided to look up the player numbers for Battlefront.
Uh-huh.
The 2015 version, the all flash and no substance. On PC, there's 13,000 players right now.
Okay.
Which, while sounds huge compared to 2,000 for a game that has no functional multiplayer and has to be played through a third-party program, it's just astonishing. But the more interesting thing is that the source I had also gave me console numbers, with Xbox One giving 60,000 and PS4 giving 94,000.
Again, I think that comes purely down to there's no competition on consoles for other things. So this is the...
Especially if you want a Star Wars shooter.
So this is a Star Wars game at all. There's no Star Wars games on the new consoles except for Battlefront now. So, it's the flavor of the week.
And it makes me wonder if console players had true backwards compatibility where they could throw in a PlayStation 3 game or PlayStation 2 game without having to rebuy it, which I think is just utter bullcrap. Would Battlefront be as popular as it is on the consoles?
I don't think so. I don't think it would be at all. So Xbox One is now doing backwards compatibility. Like, that's launched fully, and they're going to keep adding titles to it as the next couple of years goes on.
Yeah, but how are they doing it? Is it, if you have the disc, you play it, or is it buying a ported copy?
If you have the disc, you can play it straight off the disc, or if you purchase the game digitally, you can re-download it for free. Otherwise, you have to buy digital versions or old discs of the game. I mean, if you own it already, you can play it in whatever form it is.
All right, well, that's a lot kinder than the PS4 version I heard, that basically the PS2 version was... You had to rebuy, otherwise you couldn't play the game. It didn't matter if you had the disc or not.
Nope. What they're doing with the Xbox One is they are just emulating the Xbox 360, 100% hardware and all.
Yeah, which gives me hope for a PC Xbox 360 emulator. Because there is a saying in the PC Master Race subreddit, no game is exclusive forever.
Yeah, that's true. I play a lot of old PS2 games. I emulate them on my PC. I got rid of my PS2.
Yeah, I have an old PS2 and an old CRT TV. There's just something about the controller. Playing it with a 360 pad just doesn't feel right.
It feels so good. I've always been a fan of the Xbox controller over the PlayStation controller.
Yeah, but there's something about the cheesiness of the PS2 DualShock 2 controllers.
I used to chew the rubber off of the thumbsticks. I would get...
What are you, maybe, a dog?
And I would get frustrated, and like people, a lot of times when they get frustrated or angry at games, they'll throw things or punch things or whatever. I would just gnaw on the rubber pads on the thumbsticks. That's what ruined many of my controllers. I'd get mad and I'd, eat the thumbstick. That's like, well, crap, I gotta go buy another controller because I've eaten the thumbsticks off and the nubs hurt my fingers.
Well, I've never broken a controller, even though I have Rage in my name, and I can definitely say I've never eaten one.
I've only broken one controller. It was a Guitar Hero guitar controller. I got so mad because the wireless controllers were buggy on, I think, Guitar Hero 3. or maybe it was World Tour. I don't know. I got mad. I literally threw it across the room and smashed it on the wall.
Did you pull a Hendrix and then set it on fire?
No, I didn't want to burn my apartment down.
Oh, damn. That would have been hilarious. You pull a Hendrix and just set a small fire on on the broken remains of the guitar or controller.
And then, like, make air sex to it, like Hendrix used to do.
And that wraps us up for the inaugural episode of the Gaming Rage-ologist podcast. I've been Caffeine Rage, joined with my co-host,
Gaming Psychologist.
If you're interested in our single work, we do each have a YouTube channel. You can find him at
Gaming Psychologist.
While I'm found at Gaming with Caffeine Rage, you know, because I'm very original with my naming.
Branding is important.
And we both also have Twitter accounts. The Gaming Psychologist can be found at JMA4707, and I can be found at Gaming with CR, with underscores between the words. Unfortunately, mine's not as easy to say.
Yeah, mine's super short.
Is there anything else you'd like to throw in?
Only my usual bye-bye now.
Ah, yes, our salute to David Spade. Bye-bye.
I always have to be last.